And finally, here is my guide to the final boss, the Ferrumbra's Mortal Shell. Before I start, just in case this is the first video you found, I have a full playlist of each seal and the respective bosses in the description below, which are required in order to get access for the final fight. Once you have access, there will be a new teleport located in the same room of the previous teleport you take to go inside the Ferrumbra's Ascension area. This one, however, will lead you somewhere else, which will be the way towards the final boss. The clip you're seeing right now was our first try on the boss, and at the time we had 14 people, which consisted of this. If your team consists of level 300s, then it is recommended to have as many people as you can, with a limit of 15 people. As everyone gets more levels and more familiar with the quest, it's not necessary to have that many people. This is good to know because it's almost guaranteed you will be losing people as weeks go by. My second attempt had 14 people show up again, and then for the third it was 8, and one time we even did it with 7. But that's only possible if people level up. I will show that in a bit, but for now, back to the guide. You all gotta follow the route I've been showing on this video like this. For supplies, mages bring around 400 avalanches, 500 SDs, and your cap on potions and fire protection. If you have a Death of Krea, I recommend to bring it as well. Paladins bring around 400 diamond arrows and 500 single target ammunition, 300 avalanches and 1k strong manas, and 100 spirits for safety. As for the knights, bring your standard equipment for hunts. You will use around 2.5k mana potions at most. Health potions depends on your druids, so bring what you feel comfortable with, and I recommend to use your leftover cap on some potions for the mages just in case. Also, everyone needs to bring 4 convincing creature runes, 2 bronze amulets, and a helmet of the deep. But Death Kalea works too, especially for mages since it is lighter on weight. Before you start the fight, everyone should try to have a spot set up for the stage 2 of the boss fight. During this, everyone should be on the southwest corner, and you wanna have everyone line up with the EKs up front and split up. The paladins on the second line, sorcerers on the third, and lastly the druids on the back. You will see this in action in a minute. I just use the word stage because it's easier that way. It could also be called different parts of the fight, but I will call them stages. At the start, on the stage 1, when everyone goes in, you wanna have one of the EKs grab the 4 demons and bring them to the southeast. His druid should stay there with him, and do not kill the demons. It's okay to lower the HP but keep them raid HP. This won't be fun, but it makes everything easier, and it should always be a knight to keep the aggro of the demons. Now, for everyone else, on this stage you gotta kill the Reef Invaders next to the light blue pillars to turn them pink. Use avalanches on this stage. There is 8 pillars in total, and it's important to not kill any invaders near the southwest pillar. This should always be last. If you do kill one, be aware of it and keep count. Move forward and start killing the invaders next to the other pillars clockwise. Although the order is not important, just so you know. If you guys are organized and only have 1 or 2 people bring the invaders to the pillars and everyone else further back, it will be easier. After turning the other pillars to pink, have everyone start getting on their positions on the southwest corner. Just so you know, the lightning on the walls do damage on melee and range, so don't stand next to them. Now, the main EK will be in charge of luring the invaders to the pillar and keep the count on how many die next to it. This is really important, as this will determine how hard stage 2 will be, and that's the hardest part of the fight. So I hope you were paying attention and didn't let any monsters die unnoticed next to the pillar. Start killing, and when you are at the 7th kill, have the EK and the ED that had the demons come join the group. As you lure the last couple invaders, kill their demons and then proceed to kill the invaders. Before the number 10 dies, the EK should ult Tiny Temple to his position. When all the pillars are pink, immediately after the Ferrumbra's Soul Splinters will spawn. This is the second stage. There will be 8 splinters and the goal is to have less than 4 come to you as they spawn. This is very luck dependent, however, if you do it properly and are not anywhere close to the pillars when they spawn, it's more likely to have less than 4. During this stage, it's good to have everyone focus on the same splitter. That is, if you are all under level 300 range. Later on, when your team has some levels, this part can be done with just avalanches and AoE damage. But even then, it's still easier and probably better to do this with a single target and everyone killing the same splinter. During this part, the damage is not very high, and mages can be without mana shield. As long as the old druids spawn the mass rest, it will be fine. But of course, this is optional. However, it may even be better to take the chance of being on HP than on mana shield, because the real problem of this part is the mana drain, which is AoE. EKs will struggle to have enough mana to attack and sometimes won't even have for the secondaries. On this part is where you should equip the Death of Krea and the Bronze Amulets. When you kill one of them, a Ferrumbra's Essence takes its place. To get rid of those, you gotta walk them on top of the portal that the invader leaves behind when they die. Keep track of each kill and do not clear the essences right away. Once all the splinters are dead, put on your Helmet of the Deep or Death Galeas. Make sure everyone has their helmet on, and then you can start working on getting rid of the essences by luring some invaders and making the portals. After you get rid of the essences, the third stage will start. Now there will be wreck fragments on the room. They are monsters that look like an energy field that will be on the corners of the room at low HP. These are the ones that do a lot of damage in the form of drowning, which is why as long as you have your helmets on, you will be fine. Do not try to go close to them without a helmet because it can headshot most of you. Open your battle list and start using the convince creature rune on them. There is 14 fragments on the rune, so a minimum of 7 people can convince all of them. But since they will be on low HP, it's important for your druid to be spamming mass rest on them, as well as everyone should be AoEing down the invaders and the demons that keep on spawning. Once you have your fragments, attack the destabilized Ferumbras on the middle. The fragments will kill him on this stage, and then he will respawn as the Ferumbras Mortal Shell, the final boss. When he respawns, do not attack him for now and have an EK bring him towards the south, ideally closer to the southwest, and then people can stay far south to the walls. The reason behind this is to stay further away as possible from the monster respawning onto the north. This will make it easier. Once he is on position, you all can start attacking and he will get trapped with the fragments. The druid should keep on using the mass rest to keep the fragment alive and it will be fine. Now, with all the fragment convinced, it's safe to swap your helmet. That is, of course, if you are sure all fragments have been convinced. If you want to play it safe, you can just keep your helmet on. To kill the Ferumbras, just attack it with the SDs. Paladin should use Sotiro the entire time, and Ike should do as much damage as you can. I have yet to determine which weapon is better to use against this boss, as I have tried with Ice, Energy, and Physical, but it's hard to say which one is better, but it does seem to be better to use Physical. Now, a couple of things and tips to know. First, if you have a big group of people, the damage won't be a problem, and some of these tips won't even matter. But anyways, the boss has an AoE that decreases distance, so if you are a paladin too close to the boss, your distance will be reduced quite often. You can take it off by using Odido, but he does it too often. So if you want to guarantee your damage, it's better to stay further away and be on Odido all the time. If you want to get better drops, however, you can stay closer to the boss and get hit by some of his spells. Because the drops from this boss takes everything into consideration. Damage given and taken, as well as healing. This is why most people try to be on the range of the beams and spells. Druids usually get a high participation just by doing your job of spamming mass rest to keep the fragments alive. Sorcerers, however, don't have much hope as damage will be on the low side since he has a lot of resistance. As for the knights, it's hard to do a lot of damage because of the mana drain. Because of this, it's good to have either a druid or a sorcerer use mana pots on you so that you can focus on doing damage. This is especially necessary when your group is low in numbers. As Ferumbra takes more damage from physical attacks, it will be more helpful for your mages to help fill the mana of the Ike so that he can do even more damage. And it's safer if a sorcerer is the one doing it. Other than that, as an Ike, if you want to increase your participation on the boss, you can take off some of your equipment to increase the damage taken by him as well as spamming etc. I'm not telling you all of this to incentivize this behavior, but rather to inform you so that you know how it works or why people like to take damage from the boss. In the end, this is a team fight, and especially when you don't have that many people, it's better to guarantee the kill than to increase your chances of looting nothing. Which is what could have happened the one time we had 7 people. Here is the clip. We were able to kill it because out of the 7 people, 3 were paladins, which are the biggest source of damage against the Ferumbras. But as you can see, we were sitting far back and not trying to take damage from the boss, which could result in reducing our distance, which most likely would have meant not getting the kill. Also, the one sorcerer we had was committed to filling the EK's mana, so in the end we were able to get it done. On these cases, when you're low on numbers, if you have one EK, he still should be the one grabbing the demons on stage 1, and the paladins can be in charge of looting the invaders to the pillars. And if you don't have majority of paladins and EKs, I wouldn't try it with less than 8 people. Now, let's talk about the drops. Me and my team have a sharing system, and I would recommend the same to you guys. But in the end, each team should set their own rules. The Mortal Shell always drops 5 items. The boots, amulet, staff, scroll, and mana cake. The boots can be used to get teleported to the Ferumbra Citadel. The amulet can refill 1k of mana or health every hour. The mana cake can be used every 20 hours to make great mana potions. The staff sucks, and the scroll can transform you into a Ferumbra or a demon. What we do with this is that if you get a repeated item, the people that don't have it roll a number for it and the winner keeps it. Eventually, everyone will get a set of these, and after that, you can do whatever with them. Next up, there is the basic drops like tokens and regular items. These are for you to keep. The middle area is the rares that usually have a value of more than 1kk, like the Demon Wing Axe, Ornament Axe, Skull Crusher, and Velvet Mantle. From this and upwards, they usually go to the highest participation player. So it tends to be unfair to the mages, but at the same time, they're too cheap to be sold and shared, so you can roll for these. The high area includes things like the Great Shield and the Death Case. And lastly, the most rare items are of course the Ferrumba's Hat and the Mysterious Scroll, used for getting the Rift Runner Mount. If there is a buyer within the team, we sell it for a discount. If not, then just sell it for full price to an outsider and then split evenly among the members. I believe this is a healthy way to do things and can give the incentive of coming back to do it again, which by the way is a boss that can be repeated every 14 days. With that aside, that is all there is for this boss and the quest. If it is your first time doing it, then grab the chest and say hi to the NPC to receive the Rift Warrior outfit and this bag. And that's it. If you like the overall guide or found it helpful, consider subscribing, or even better, if you feel generous after looting a rare from these bosses, you can give me a donation in Tibia coins to Goodie Donation, which will be used to come up with even more content. Thank you for watching.